Welcome back to Sound 101. I am Andrew from Deity Microphones, and today's episode, we're going to be examining whether or not a TRS cable is as good as an XLR cable. So let's get started. Well, a lot of you guys have been asking all about 3.5 millimeter cables and can you use them with your XLR microphones? And we'll just knock this one out of the bat. Asking these kinds of questions that are up on my screen right now is how you win a VLOV. These lovely people are all winners. And all they had to do was drop a comment down in that section below that said hashtag mailbag and ask us a question. Now, typically those kinds of mailbag questions are used for our mailbag episodes. Link right up here if you want to bounce over there and see our Q&A with me and Deity Steve. But some of these questions are like really good. And we were like, let's just make it a whole episode. We're going to explain what makes that TRS cable really all that different than an XLR cable and break down what are these connectors and why is it this is considered professional and why is this considered not. So let's get started. What is a TRS cable? Well, a TRS cable, according to this graphic right here, is a tip ring sleeve cable. What that means is the tip, also known as pin one, carries the hot signal. Traditionally, there are some companies out there that like to move it around and not play by the rules. We got the ring, and that is considered the cold. Sometimes this doesn't even connect to anything. Sometimes it's something referred to as float. And then we also have the sleeve, which is the last one, which has the ground. I mean, it's literally considered nothing as it's connected to literally just the chassis of the body. Now, here's where it gets really kind of crazy. We also have something called TS and TRRS. Now you may be saying to yourself, they look similar to TRS. What's the difference between these two kinds of things? And that is simple. This guy over here, the TS jack, is just a tip and sleeve. So you have the hot and the ground, and the whole thing right there is the ground. I mean, it's not divided up like the TRS cable, or sometimes the TRS cable does have that middle one that is sometimes used as the right channel. But in terms of microphones, tip being hot, sleeve being ground, ring not usually coming into effect. So let's actually now look over here to my other side, and that is the TRRS cable. Now you may say to yourself, I thought the little black rings were the connectors. No, it's actually the gold that's in between the rings. The rings themselves are actually the insulators. So we have the tip, hot. We have the ring, hot. Hold on, that's different. That's right, a TRRS cable has two hots, and those are typically for your headphones. So it's either the left and right outputs. Sometimes it's other things, but usually it's the left and right outputs. Then we have a second R, and that is the actual ground. It's not the sleeve, like over here with the TS and the TRRS. And then we actually have the sleeve, and that is mic. Yeah, okay, so this is really different. It's technically another hot, and it's actually a mic level hot signal that's actually coming back into the device. Traditionally, then you end up with situations where all of this doesn't make any sense because you have, say, something like the iPod Nano, which is headphone, ground, 5 volt for charging the unit. That's not standard, but it kind of has become its own standard within devices that don't have mic inputs like iPods and MP3 players now. So now we know what a TRS is, a TS and a TRRS. How does any of this reflect to a XLR? So now let's actually take a look at the pinout for an XLR. So over here, what you guys can see is we've got 1, 2, and 3. Pin number one is the ground, very different than our TRS cables. We have pin number two, which is actually the hot. That's actually the one that carries your microphone signal. And then we have pin number three, which is acting as our common return kind of a pin. So you'll immediately notice the XLR cable has everything that the TRS cable has. So can't they just work together, right? I mean, like, you just gotta connect that pin with that pin, and well, we'll just kind of draw a line in the middle. Well, not exactly. And let's explain why that is. So when we're actually taking a look at the connector themselves, we'll need to talk about really what they're plugging into. And for this example, we've got the Deity HDTX pocket recorder, 2.4 gigahertz. If you want to go get one, you can get one whenever you want. So let's actually take a look at the actual connector. We have a TRS jack. We've got an XLR jack. Now you may say to yourself, practically the same thing, right? Why did you have to have both in one device? And it's very simple. Phantom power cannot be done on a TRS jack. So if you've got a TRS jack, I don't care if it's a 1/4 inch jack or it's a 3.5 millimeter jack, you're going to fry your microphone if you apply phantom power to a mic that uses one of these. Okay, simple as that. Now let's actually take a look at the XLR connector. The pins are separated horizontally from each other. They're not in a vertical row like a TRS jack. So even if I wanted to, I can't shove this in any other direction than the proper direction, which means my ground pin here will always make contact with my ground pin here, which means the 48 volts that this thing is supplying will never accidentally cross pins with this microphone. Now, this is really important because you want to make sure you get a high quality connector and a high quality cable that's not going to have any frayed wires up in here. Often when you see these things done, you'll see little heat shrink inside and it's really nice and protected and it looks chef's kiss, right? Like this is really just critical because the last thing you want is to send 48 volts into your brand new microphone and just have it immediately fry. That's why we often tell people don't try to go and make your own cables if you don't know what you're doing, okay? So the last thing I want to do is take something like this, plug it in, and on that end be a 3.5 millimeter and go into something like the D4 Duo. If I were to do that, 48 volts is way too much for this microphone to handle. This thing likes to run off 3 to 5 volts bias voltage. What is bias voltage? Well, that's actually what 3.5 millimeter cables run on. And let's actually now talk about what bias voltage is and why it's sometimes called plug-in power and why it's confused with phantom power. Let's break it all down. So bias voltage is 3 volts typically, but it can be anywhere between 1 to 10 volts. And it's on the hot pin, not the phantom pin or the ground pin. Let's take our big giant connector here. So reference, as we insert it in, so you'll notice the very last pin that gets touched is the tip. Well, that's the one with the voltage, which means the other pin will never, never come into contact with the connector for that pin, which means the 3 volts that we typically run on will never get sent backwards through the microphone. Now, bias voltage does also have a bunch of wacky names. It's sometimes called plug-in power. Sometimes it's called bias voltage. Sometimes it's just called mic plus. So now let's actually talk about the last thing we need to talk about in terms of TRS versus XLR, and that is this: unbalanced versus balanced. Sometimes. What is a balanced cable? What is an unbalanced cable? What a balanced cable means is it is 3 wires, all for 1 microphone signal right here. This is a XLR cable. These are balanced cables most of the time. And a TRS jack is unbalanced because it does not have the inversed phase flip on its cold pin like an XLR cable traditionally does, which makes it unbalanced, which means in theory, this is much more susceptible to interference. Now, I'm going to tell you a little story about a shoot I did up in Buffalo, New York, across the street from a radio station that played lovely country music. And the reason why I know they played lovely country music, or the fact that I knew that they even existed, is because every single XLR cable I had on my show was picking up the station. And you could hear it in your intercom system. Now, why could the intercom system hear it even though it was using shielded, supposedly balanced XLR cables? Because the intercom systems are unbalanced. And we were running at 300 feet, perfectly tuned to the radio station itself in the length of its antenna, turning our whole cable system into a giant antenna array to pick up this FM country station. How did we get rid of it? Well, we first kicked all of our coils so it wasn't creating some kind of induction capacitor. And then what we ended up doing was adding 25-foot cables to the end of our length to kind of tune the radio station to not be the one that we were currently listening to. That said, they were doing a giveaway and we really tried to call in. Not lying, that's a real part of the story. We did. Now, XLR cables, you can look at them and you go, oh, it's a balanced cable, it's shielded. This is never gonna have an issue. 100% not true. If you want to take a look and actually see that in effect, you can click over to this link over here on the wish.com video where we bought an XLR cable that was luxury, and yet we were able to prove that the good cable got zero interference. The cheap cable was picking up noise all the time. The important part is not to talk about balance versus unbalanced and all that other stuff. The important part is to talk about the shielding itself. You can get a high quality TRS cable that is shielded, double shielded, and I have even seen triple shielded cables that do a really good job, even though they are unbalanced, which means they are prone to that interference issue. And this is actually the diagram for the TRS cable that is sitting right here in front of me. And you'll see that diagram has a foil shield as well as a braided shield. So it's a double shielded cable. And what they're calling a triple shield on this particular model is the nylon braiding that just kind of makes it a little bit more durable and tangle proof. I wouldn't call it a shield so much, but I've seen some people actually refer to this as triple shield. And you know what though, for $10, it's not a bad little cable to get. We do recommend it. And at 25 feet, it doesn't seem to really pick up a whole lot of interference. Now, If you do get interference, you're probably getting it from a couple of different things. Doesn't matter if you're running TRS or XLR. Here's a couple of tips you can do to make sure your cables, be it either of these, don't get interference. Tip number one is don't run it next to power cables, especially if it's a mains voltage cable at 120 volts, or for you Europeans over there, 240, which is just ridiculous. You're definitely going to pick up some kind of induction interference coming off the magnetism of the power cable. And every single little coil in your power cable is just going to increase the possibility of getting interference. The other thing you got to do is make sure the cable you have doesn't have a broken shield. I don't care how good the shielding is. If a little part of it is broken internally, you're going to have problems all day. The way you can check this is every now and then do maintenance on your cables. Check them out. Check for shorts. A short usually means a short in the braided cable part, which is actually going to give you the interference. So if you've got shorts in your cable, cut them out and re-terminate all your connectors. And lastly, buy premium cables to begin with. They're gonna last you a lot longer than the cheaper stuff. And if you're gonna buy it, you might as well only have to buy it once. There's not like new technology coming out that makes your old XLR cables from the 90s like no longer relevant. So if you buy it once, really good, especially something that's an evergreen product like this, it should last you easily 10 years if you treat it properly with respect. So those are our tips for buying a cable, be it TRS or XLR. It's a nice little bonus thing here in this episode. And at the end of the day, that's all you really do care about. Don't care so much about whether or not this isn't professional. This is professional. At the end of the day, does it sound good? Does it get the job done for you? And if that's the case, then it's professional enough. Well, that is going to wrap it up for us. If you like this kind of content, you got to hit that subscribe button so you find out when we post new videos every single week. Hit that bell for notification and you will be one of the first people to be alerted. Hey, if you really like this kind of content and you want to see more content and something maybe you got a problem with, you can always drop that down in the comment section below, hashtag mailbag at the beginning of your comment. What that allows you to do is possibly be entered to win a VLOV in one of our mailbag episodes. And if it's a phenomenal question, you could actually have a whole dedicated video set up just for you and still win a VLOV, which means we are doubling the amount of chances for you guys to win VLOVs here on our YouTube channel. Well, that's going to wrap it up for me. I am Andrew from Deity Microphones, and thank you for watching.